NUP Curazao Bay Area Representative David Dito Vega very critical with COVID-19. We'll have the latest from the Prime Minister. And PM Bersenyo returns to work in Belmopan but says he's still testing positive. Also, what can government do to prevent more people from dying in parking lots? Plus, we'll take you to PG for the story of the fireman shot while he was sitting inside the station. Oh, we've got details of these and other stories in our newscast for tonight, Monday, December 7th, 2020. Good evening. With your news, I'm Indra Craig.
Make your Christmas bright this year with a quick and easy loan from QuickStop in December and make no payments until January. Visit your nearest QuickStop branch or apply online at quickstoponline.com. Offer ends December 31st. QuickStop Personal Finance Center. No hassle loans.
You've worked hard your whole life building your future, your family, your business, your home. And when you aren't around to safeguard your most beloved assets, you are at ease because you know they are protected by RF&G Insurance. For over 50 years, RF&G has been making sure business owners get back to work after an accident and families get back into their homes quickly after a natural disaster. At RF&G, it's you who matters most. Visit us today and learn why it pays to get it right. RF&G Insurance, a road group company.
'Twas the weeks before Christmas, and all through the store, all the family was preparing for what was in store. Preparations being made, decorations being hung. Everyone did their part to ready the best deals in town. Because at Brother Sabet, it's that time of year where the colors of the rainbow are ours to share. Yes, Berger, Valspar, Domestic, and Penta are month discounted by 15%. And not just that, so please don't forget, we have deals on much more in the store, you bet. Power tools, tiles, Westinghouse light fixtures, and a whole clearance section, my brothers and sisters. Plus our annual 12 Days of Christmas promotion. Win $500 gift certificates for your devotion. So come to Brother Sabet, and Habet and Habet too, wishing a Merry Christmas from all of we to you.
For hydration, when the choice is yours, choose the brand you have always trusted. Crystal Water, taste you can trust.
The virus that causes COVID-19 may be spreading in our community. People might have the disease even if they have no symptoms at all, even when they look healthy. Because the virus needs us to spread from one person to another, we can stop it from infecting others if we practice physical distancing. That means stay at least 6 feet away from other persons. Don't shake hands or exchange hugs. Do not gather in groups. Stay home if government officials tell you to do so. Use social media or telephone to communicate. Avoid crowded and enclosed spaces. Work from home if you can. Stay home if you are sick except to get medical care. Avoid close contact with sick people. Don't visit anyone who's sick in quarantine or in isolation. Give them a call instead. Help keep Belize safe.
Ray, what's wrong? It's him. He hit me again.
Oh my gosh.
This time it was worse. He slammed my face in the wall and threatened to kill me.
If you or someone you know is experiencing family violence, call 0800 The Way Out. Or you can text or WhatsApp to 672-9628. This message is brought to you by the National Women's Commission, funding from Be and Gender and Spotlight Projects.
Stay safe and submit your sickness benefit claim form electronically. Follow these four steps. Step 1. Obtain your medical certificate. At consultation, the doctor certifies your days of illness and provides you with a medical certificate. Step 2. Fill out your sickness benefit form. Complete all the fields in parts 1 to 4 on the front page of the sickness benefit form. Step 3. Request your salaries record form. Contact your employer for your salaries record form. Step 4. Submit your sickness benefit claim form. Scan or take a clear picture of the sickness benefit form, salaries record, and proof of bank account. Email the documents to claims@socialsecurity.org.bz within 14 days. You will receive an email reply confirming receipt of your claim. After the submission of all documents, your claim is processed for payment to your account. For any COVID-related illnesses, contact the Ministry of Health for further guidance. Social Security Board, safeguarding you, your family, your future.
He was swept into office 26 days ago, but tonight David Dito Vega is at Belize Healthcare Partners fighting for his life. He's in a very critical condition with COVID-19. The 47-year-old had tested positive a week ago, but had to be rushed to the ICU in Belize City after his health took a drastic turn on Saturday morning. He started having difficulty breathing, and that was the sign that the COVID-19 had moved into his respiratory system. Today at his office in Belize City, Prime Minister John Briceño gave the press an update on Vega, saying that he was doing all right up until the middle of last week.
When he was found that he had, he was positive on Wednesday, I spoke to him and he sounded pretty much normal. He said, I feel a little bit tired, Prime Minister, but I'm doing good. So I said, I'm going to keep in touch with you. On Friday, then I found out that he was at a small private clinic in Corozal, so that he, in a way, isolated from his family. And I spoke to him, and he sounded well. And again, saying, I'm getting therapy for my lungs, and the cupping and so forth. So I'm taking out a lot of phlegm, but I'm okay. I'm coping. He did not sound like really sick. Saturday morning, when I was informed that he was being moved, I immediately called his family, and then they said, he just suddenly had a turn for the worst. All of a sudden, he started having problems with the breathing and so forth, and they felt that it's best to bring him to Belize City. So we quickly arranged for him to come to Belize Healthcare Partners. And again, there, when he was there, they stabilized him, and he was doing well all this Saturday. Then around 10, 11, I was alerted that he just took again a sudden turn, boom, to the bar, and they'll have to intubate him. So he was intubated, and again he was normalized. And then Sunday morning when I hear that again he had another turn, and they're having problems and struggling to keep him stable. Fortunately, it seems that they finally managed to stabilize him, but he's still critical. So, the doctors are doing all they can, and, we are a people of faith, so I'm asking everyone to please pray for Dito Vega.
I read somewhere that there was some improvement today, however, that his oxygen levels were normalized.
Well, his oxygen levels have been normalized since last night, but what they had to do is that the machine was at its fullest. It couldn't go anymore. So if something would have happened, the machine couldn't, put in more oxygen or pump in more oxygen. So that was of concern. But I'm told today that they have managed to bring down the strength of the machine. So the machine still have leeway to be able, should something happen to that they need to fight to go up to increase his oxygen levels.
Sir, Mr. Prime Minister, we know that persons on respirators, speaking in the plainest terms, As far as I know, only one person has been extubated and has survived, and that's the doctor from the Western region. Once you're intubated in Belize, the sad reality is your chances of survival are not high. We're told Mr. Vega's lungs are significantly built up with mucus, which we know is a symptom of COVID.
That's why I said it's still critical. Statistically, it's about 80% of the people will be okay. 20%, 15% will need medical attention, and 5% are going to intubation. So the thing is to make sure that 15% don't go there. So we have to do everything possible to try to keep people away from getting to intubation. And the intubation is not only that it's very difficult to survive, because even in the other countries, you have rates as high as more than 60% of not surviving. So what we need to do, the strategy has to be that 15% or that 20% is to give them the proper medical attention so that they don't need intubation.
So as you heard, Vega remains very critical, so we'll keep following his condition closely. He is one of many senior PUP officials with COVID-19. As has been extensively reported, the Prime Minister himself has tested positive. He spent 2 weeks in quarantine at home and returned to work today, even though his last PCR test was still positive for COVID. He explained why today.
So on Friday, a doctor from the Ministry of Health, Dr. Quay, went to do two things: to give me the PCR test and also to clinically examine me. As I said, I had no symptoms. I had no fever, no headache, no pains, no diarrhea, nothing. No loss of smell or taste. So she then took the PCR test and then examined me. And she then declared me, what do you call it right here? I'm clinically recovered. Okay. And that I could have moved around from then, but I still stayed. My wife insisted, you're going to do your 14 days, so I stayed until Sunday. So today is the first time that I'm really out, and I'm here back to work. I must tell you that my PCR test came back, and it is still positive. But when I'm talking to the doctors, and as we all know, the CDC and other, and also in Europe, they are saying that once you pass the period where you can be, that you are infectious. Once you pass that period, then you can continue with your life. Ironically, I did not get, it seems that I did not get the virus from the campaign. I thought if it's going to happen, it's going to happen on election night. But it seems that I got it right here within this office. So I say that to drive the point home. Wear your mask and keep your mask on at all times, apart from your bubble, which is your immediate family.
And while Briceño returned to work today, his Minister of State, Toledo East, Mike Espat, returned to work after his bout with COVID-19. While PUP Belize Rural Central Rep, Dolores Valderamas Garcia, is still recovering from COVID-19. And Cayo West Rep, George Melina Espat, is on the rebound after a scare. PM Briceño discussed those cases today.
Now, Jorge or Melin Espat gave us a little scare for a little while because he was struggling for a while. But fortunately, then we got the remdesivir, the medication. Mm-hmm. And once they gave it to him, then he started to improve rather quickly. But he was never intubated. So that's the big thing. Once they intubate you, that is when you get into trouble.
Minister Dolores?
Sorry?
Right.
Oh, yeah, Minister Dolores, yes, she is also positive, but she is asymptomatic. When I spoke to her, she says, again, she has no symptoms of that COVID-19 would give you, so she's doing well.
Your Chief of Staff, sir, Mr. Leslie, has seen...
Yes, and my Chief of Staff, that's why I say in my office you had my Chief of Staff that got sick also. He is recovered also, clinically recovered. Well, I think he took a rapid test yesterday, I think. He's at work now. He had to go to Bobopan today. So is Ms. Nada Garcia. She is recovered. She is now at work today in Bobopan.
So with so many leading PUP personalities positive for COVID-19, it could point back to the November 11 general election and the celebrations that followed. We asked the Prime Minister if that was the super spreader.
After the election, inevitably, there were celebrations, and we saw you as well. We know how you crave contact with your supporters. We saw you as well when leaving the Belize House. You were in the embrace of others. Have you all looked at the likelihood that the election victory and the aftermath of celebration, which is hard to stop, might have been the index event or the super spreader event which led to these multiple PUP infections?
Well, obviously, any event that you have could have the spread of the virus. I mean, you could have a party at your home, and then everybody in the home is sick, and even other friends that would come. So any event that we have, that brings me to the point to say even Christmas now, we have to be careful not to have parties for this Christmas. I mean, and I usually invite my entire family for Christmas and my extended family, and already my wife is saying, no, it's just us, we can't invite anybody. So yes, the answer is quite likely the election, as much as we tried our best to be careful, I think during the day, I think we did a pretty good job. But, you know, everybody wore their masks and everybody's cleaning their hands. We're trying not to be over there in large numbers on the polling station. But in the night with the euphoria of the victory, you know, people just, you know, I mean, even though it wasn't as big, could have been much bigger. I mean, if we did not have the restrictions, people still came out. And, you know, and they're embracing one another and they're drinking. So I'm sure that, of course, some of that has contributed.
And while there may have been plenty of new cases stemming from the general elections in the here and now, the Kumpol is trying to reduce cases in various workplaces. He made an impassioned post on Facebook this morning reminding employers that they should not be forcing employees who have COVID-19 or are awaiting test results to come into work, inevitably causing an even greater spread. Today, he told us that he plans to speak with the Minister of Health to amend the law to be able to charge these employers.
We have been receiving a number of complaints from employees who are aware of other employees who have tested positive for COVID-19, and the employer, on the other hand, is refusing to have these employees who have tested positive go home to isolate. These employees are still being told to come to work despite the fact that they are COVID positive. Secondly, we also got complaints that there are some where the employees have gone to do the tests and are awaiting results. And again, employers are telling them that they need to be at work pending the results. Now, it is the law that once it is that you have tested positive for COVID-19, that you need to isolate yourself from others. It is also the law that once you have been swabbed and are awaiting result, that you are to be in quarantine pending your results. And we would anticipate that any responsible employer would want to ensure that an employee who is infected or who is potentially infected would not be at work to further infect other employees or to put other employees at risk.
Meanwhile, the employees can still be charged for breach of quarantine. And while employers are afraid of being short-staffed, the police department is already facing that dilemma. To make matters worse, a second officer died last week Wednesday from COVID-19. But he didn't die in a hospital bed like most other patients. As we told you, Police Corporal David Jimenez passed away in an ambulance in the KHMH's parking lot. Today, Kumpol Chester Williams said that while he is not blaming the hospital, the police officers deserve better as frontline workers.
It is indeed an unfortunate situation where the police officer began experiencing breathing problems sometime around 6 a.m. Bert were called in. They responded quickly, ferried the officer to the KHMH, and upon arrival there, he was refused access to the KHMH where he could have received treatment. Now, we're not going to say that had he received the treatment or some treatment from KHMH, he would have survived. But the fact of the matter is that he died outside in the ambulance, and that ought not to have occurred. From what I was briefed by Mr. Steen from BERT, who responded, was that they waited outside for over 3 hours, and despite their continued requests for the officer to go in to receive treatment, he was denied. The BERT personnel tried their utmost best to try to give the officer oxygen and to keep him alive, but that failed, and the officer subsequently died. And so I have talked with the Minister of Health, and again, it is something that the KHMH administration need to look into, because hospital authorities do have an obligation by law to ensure that they treat patients who come to them, irrespective of the situation. So we need to see how better can be done, because not just because it's a police, but anybody who goes to the hospital, it is expected that the hospital is going to provide them with the treatment that they need, with a view to see how we can survive. Police officers are frontline people. We're out there every day doing our job. We're meeting sometimes hundreds of persons per day, and we are pretty much exposed to the virus. And so it is the least you can do is to ensure that whenever we're infected and we go to the hospital to seek attention, that we're given the level of attention that we deserve.
Meanwhile, other officers have been putting in extra time to ensure the safety of citizens. And while Jimenez was the first to die waiting in the KHMH parking lot, it happened again on Thursday when another man in respiratory distress died right there waiting. We asked the Prime Minister today what is being done to prevent reoccurrences.
We're hearing about people dying in parking lots. The police officer Jimenez, I think, from Corozal or Orange Rock as well. And over the weekend, I think you had two other cases like that.
What is happening is that one of the things that I found today, that we set up protocols, but it stays there. It does not go from, say, Calhoun to Northern Regional or the Southern Regional, so that people get there and now they're waiting there to get that attention. For instance, now they have some mobile oxygen tanks, small oxygen tanks, so that when you come and you need attention, they can go right out there at the parking lot to be able to start to give you oxygen while they start the process to get you in. Apparently, because of the database that the health system has, it's a fairly extensive one, and so they have to enter a lot of data, and sometimes they take too long. So again, we have to reconsider how we or reconfigure that whole thing, that probably we have just civilians entering the data while the doctor is starting to really look at you clinically to make sure what kind of attention you need so that we can do this much quicker.
So with all the deaths and cases piling up, the need for public awareness is higher than ever. Government says it will step up advertising, but we asked the expert with the Director of Health Services, which hasn't aired since October 22nd. Here's our exchange.
That we will be needing your stations, your TV stations or radio stations to probably be putting announcements every single hour of the day. For people to understand, man, this thing here, you have to do your part, you have to help to be able to protect not only yourself, but your family and the loved ones. So we're all in this together.
In that light, will there be a resumption of Ask the Experts, which was a public information platform?
We want to do it slightly different. And I think what we want to do is to have a daily short video of explaining what is taking place every day. So not just show the numbers and you try to understand what is going on, but that's one of the things that the minister just mentioned that we'll be going to be doing that. And certainly if Ask the Expert is something that is necessary, of course we're going to do it. You know, we need to do any and everything.
Is the CEO and Minister of Health and Wellness in office yet, Ms. Mendez?
No, she's working from home. Who is again suffering from COVID? Her mother has COVID. And Dido, she was Dido's campaign manager and Dido's sister-in-law. And I think Dido's other family members seems to also have COVID.
Reliable reports say that the Director of Health Services, Dr. Marvin Manzanero, has been made to take a back seat since the change of government. We'll take a break now. When we come back, we'll go to PG for the story of the fireman murdered as he sat watching YouTube in the fire station. Don't go away.
Benny's Deal Alert season is here, and we have some great deals for you.
Deals, deals, and more deals. From now up until December 31st, enjoy Deal Alert discounts on our line of paints, such as BH paints, Texture Light paints, and Tropical Colors paints. Deal Alert markdowns will also be applied on a wide selection of tiles, lights and fans, tools, appliances, and much more.
And remember, whenever you make a purchase, you get double tickets to enter our cash giveaway draw on December 19th to win $10,000.
That's right. It's a Deal Alert. It's a Bennett's Deal Alert. So shop now. Get great deals and your tickets for the chance to win the $10,000 grand prize only at Bennett's. Bennett's in 60 seconds.
You've worked hard your whole life building your future, your family, your business, your home. And when you aren't around to safeguard your most beloved assets, you are at ease because you know they are protected by RF&G Insurance. For over 50 years, RF&G has been making sure business owners get back to work after an accident and families get back into their homes quickly after a natural disaster. At RF&G, it's you who matters most. Visit us today and learn why it pays to get it right. RF&G Insurance, a Rowe Group company.
Beer of Belize.
The virus that causes COVID-19 may be spreading in our community. People might have the disease even if they have no symptoms at all, even when they look healthy. Because the virus needs us to spread from one person to another, we can stop it from infecting others if we practice physical distancing. That means stay at least 6 feet away from other persons. Don't shake hands or exchange hugs. Do not gather in groups. Stay home if government officials tell you to do so. Use social media or telephone to communicate. Avoid crowded and enclosed spaces. Work from home if you can. Stay home if you are sick, except to get medical care. Avoid close contact with sick people. Don't visit anyone who is sick in quarantine or in isolation. Give them a call instead. Help keep Belize safe.
Ray, what's wrong? It's him. He hit me again.
Oh my gosh.
This time it was worse. He slammed my face in the wall and threatened to kill me.
If you or someone you know is experiencing family violence, call 0800 The Way Out. Or you can text or WhatsApp to 672-9628. This message is brought to you by the National Women's Commission. Funding from Be and Gender and Spotlight Projects.
Every day, women and men in Belize become victims of gender-based violence, which results in emotional, sexual, financial, and physical abuse. Are you a survivor of gender-based violence and in imminent danger? Don't be afraid. There are ways you can get help. You can call our free emergency numbers at 0800-AWAY-OUT or text or WhatsApp 672-9628 or call 911 to make a report at any time of the day or night. A police officer will assist you. You can also contact the Women and Family Support Department for Women Abuse or the Department of Human Services for Child Abuse in your district to discuss options for temporary housing or medium to long-term care and psychosocial support. You can also go directly to the Family or Magistrate Court and obtain a protection order that restrains the abuser from coming in contact with you, or apply for an occupation and tenancy order that orders the abuser to leave the home for the period of time they see fit. Visiting your nearest hospital or polyclinic for medical attention or further referrals is also something you can do. Together, we can end gender-based violence in Belize. We are here to help you. This message is brought to you by the National Women's Commission with funding from the Engender and Spotlight Projects with support from the Department of Youth Services.
Contraband is the illegal importation of goods such as alcohol, tobacco, foods, and parts. Apart from breaking the law, smugglers are also now endangering the health of all Belizeans. They risk bringing coronavirus into Belize with their contraband. To keep COVID-19 out of Belize, everyone entering the country is screened and quarantined. But contraband smugglers are not using legal entry points and are bypassing all safety measures. And these same smugglers are moving among the population. They could be carrying the virus. By coming into the country illegally, they could cause outbreaks of COVID-19. Buying or smuggling contraband is putting yourself, your family, and the entire country at risk. Report smuggling. For SMART, call 0800-JUMPERS or 0800-BORDERS. For Digi, 0800-SAVE-BZE. This message is brought to you by the Belize Police Department and the Belize Bank.
Year-old fireman Rudolph Matura's priorities were taking care of his children and advancing in career, two things that were unexpectedly taken away from him when he was murdered on Friday. In his case, death came through a window as the fireman was at work sitting on an old couch watching YouTube videos. Now the family and friends of this firefighter of 8 years are left in shock. Portna Menzies has this story.
A fireman in line for a promotion was gunned down at his workplace on Friday. 29-year-old Rudolph Matura had just arrived at work and was watching YouTube videos to pass the time when he was shot in the left temple and just above his mouth. His body was found just before 6:30, sitting in a brown chair with his phone still in his hand. His sister, Stacey Matura, said that this is the second death their family is faced with in the last 6 months.
He was well known as Handsome Blacks. He may very well known. A lot of people may know brother. Nobody know my brother as no trouble boy and then kind. He na me a jovial person. He always happy and he always willing to make friends. So I could tell you miss the chance, my brother. This shock we completely catch we off guard. I just got like what, well, less than five, about 5 months I buried my son where the gas truck me knocked down. No, if we make this thing can happen, I read it to you again before this year. I don't mean it really, this hurt.
And he never once confided in you that he felt like he was in danger?
Mr. Then, you know, we are not really want to get down, you know, then details direct, but like I tell you, all I could say, then chance me, brother.
And while Matura's sister refrained from giving too many details, the police revealed that he was in a previous altercation. They are now looking for a named suspect.
What the police know so far is that Mr. Matura, along with another fireman, had reported for duty sometime just before 6 p.m. on Friday. And whilst they were inside the office, a male person whose description was not properly given came to the window where he produced a handgun and fired several shots in the direction of Mr. Matura, fatally injuring him. As we know that sometime about a month ago, he had had an altercation with several persons where he was beaten. He did go in and make a police report concerning the incident. And shortly thereafter, he went back and withdrew that report, requesting no court action. So those persons are also being looked at in relation to this investigation.
His second family, the firefighters in Punta Gorda, are also mourning the loss of their brother. The officer commanding at the station told us the team was close-knit and is now requesting counseling service for the other firemen.
Was he in any trouble?
Not that I know of, because the gentleman is an individual that he keeps his personal life, and we don't intervene when it comes to personal thing. We basically, when it comes to our job, we get our job done. Yeah, he's a respectable guy when it comes to there on the duty, although he has a little medical condition.
Okay.
So that is something that we try to cope along with him and look after his health condition, because there's several times that he got sick on us here on duty.
Okay.
And we would be the one to look after him. Since I took over office here in July, we were just working together, and him and myself, we just got a certificate of completion of our next promotion, and he was up for a promotion to a leading firefighter.
Now, Matura's three young children are left without a father, and Matura's sister said there will be no Christmas for their family this year. Courtney Menzies, 7 News.
Matura had 1 4-year-old child and 2 1-year-old children. He also leaves behind his common-law wife. Crime continues in the St. Martin's area as 25-year-old Ryan Cole was shot several times before 9 yesterday morning. Cole was on the stairs of his mother's house on Tibru Street when the gunman pulled up. Cole's family is saying that he had no gang affiliation and could be found either at home or at work. But now the police are saying otherwise.
Investigation revealed that Ryan Cole was on Tibru Street doing laundry when he was approached by a male person, and they had a discussion. Thereafter, the male person pulled out a firearm and fired several shots towards his direction, causing his injuries. Ryan Cole is presently admitted in the KHMH in a critical condition at this time.
Sir, so at close range he was shot?
Yes, he was shot at close range. This investigation, it is an internal matter within that area. With persons that are feuding in that area. We are seeking one suspect for that shooting at this time.
Cole was charged for the robbery at Freetown Drug Store that occurred in 2018. His mother said since then he has turned over a new leaf. She also told us off camera that she saw the entire incident as it unfolded. She screamed for the gunman to spare her son, but he did not pay her any attention. Now, Cole has a 50-50 chance of surviving and will have emergency surgery on Wednesday. His mother is asking the public for any type of assistance as she is not working. She can be reached at 664-8448. And so while another shooting has occurred in the St. Martin's area, the Compo said it's not from lack of mediation. We have previously reported that Compol Williams is on a mission to squash the gang violence in that area. He told the media today that he is appealing to the softer side of these gang members, letting them know that they can't fight fire with fire. He said that with his crime-fighting team, he is hopeful that they will be able to suppress the gang activity.
The St. Martin's area is extremely challenging, I must say, and it has a lot to do with the clusters of gangs that resides in that area and the close proximity within which they resides. And myself, Ms. Westby from CYDP, and Brother Nuri, we have been active on the grounds in that area trying to see how we can quell the issues between these different factions. And while, yes, we have the shooting of Brian Cold, the good thing about that is that it was internal within the PIV gang and not an issue where Bacalan and PIV were going at each other. And so the fact that it is internal, it is more easier to contain as opposed to them going at each other. We are supposed to have another session this evening at 4 with the different fractions. Again, I would have you to see how we can keep the peace going much longer and to forge a more prominent prominent solution moving forward. And so there's a lot of work that needs to be done. We have also solicited the assistance of Mr. Cordell Hyde, and he is on board with us, working in the background to see what he can do from a political standpoint, looking at the economical issues that affects the people in St. Martin's area, and then he is going to see how he can assist us with that. And so we believe that with the different groups that we have working with us, we'll be able to find a good solution to the problem. And notwithstanding that, we as police, we have to remain vigilant on the grounds. We cannot put our guards down because we know that flare-ups are always possible within the Martins area. And so we need to do what we can to ensure that there is no flare-ups. Because once you have one, then it becomes extremely difficult to contain.
Recent shooting of Ryan Cole follows 4 murders in that area in the past 2 weeks. But it wasn't gang violence that caused the house to come down in San Ignacio on Sunday. It was a truck rolling downhill that couldn't stop. Residents of that home are lucky to be alive after a 10-wheeler truck crashed into the home. It happened on Sunday around 10 in the morning, and police gave the details today.
What the police know so far is that the truck was being driven by one Irvin Torres, and according to him, he was moving a number of materials when he was going in that direction, and he seemingly lost control of the truck due to some mechanical problems. The occupants of the home, one Julie Magali and her 2 children, Melvin Multalvan, 9 years, and Jamid Multalvan, 7 years, received minor injuries. The driver was detained by police and later released pending the investigation. What we also have been able to gather is that those persons concerned have approached the family and have indicated that they will compensate for the damages. A statement has not yet been recorded from the witness. We are in the process of doing that at this time.
According to police, the driver of the vehicle did not seem to be inebriated. Police are still investigating a fire in Pomona Village that took the life of 45-year-old Vernon Alexander Williams on December 2nd. That's because there is still the question of whether it was an accident or a suicide. Today, ACP Joseph Myvitt said that while they have done the post-mortem, they are still unsure of what caused the fire.
A post-mortem was conducted on the body, and the findings are that he died from thermal injuries as well as smoke inhalation. The cause of the fire is undetermined because of the extent of the damages caused by the fire. However, we also learned that the body was found near a butane gas tank and that he had uttered certain comments to certain people the day in question when the incident occurred.
So possibly a suicide?
Could have been, but it's still an open investigation which we are following all those information that has been given to us in relation to this.
Initial reports to the fire department were that Williams had been in the middle of some domestic troubles. Changing gears now, if you were out and about in the city last Wednesday, you may have found that your car or your legs were more than half submerged in water. The good news was that once the rain had stopped and the tide had gone out, the water ran off the streets and back where it came from. Still, it left quite an amount of damage in its wake, mainly in the form of waterlogged and broken roads. This morning, Cherise Halsall traveled some of those roads to catch up with Works Councillor Albert Vaughan. He told us just how the City Council dealt with the inundation and what it needs from Belmopan now to get back on track.
It's been over a month since the floodwaters caused by Hurricane Eta and compounded by Hurricane Iota have hit every part of the country. They were especially bad in the West. And last week, Belize City finally got its share. It's a situation that the city councillor in charge of works, Albert Vaughan, is not only responsible for, but extremely concerned about.
The water coming down seems to have combined together, and so it has thrown a lot of water in Belize City, all over the city. You know, Pongyad and the other area, there's a project that is going on right now for the, it's a Ministry of Works project with the canals and the Orion Street. And so what may have happened there was that the sort of clogging and the volume of water, I understand that the tide was also high too, and so that water came up. But as soon as that water came up, and as soon as the tide gone down, that water had flown out much freely. Our major problem was in the Belama area, where we have seen never before a massive flood that it has extended out to Belama Phase 3 and also extended out to Belama Phase 4.
Vaughan says the council was proactive and did its best, along with SEMO, to provide assistance. Still, he says it's new and ongoing developments that have disrupted the city's natural drainage systems.
The road, or the highway, the George Price Highway, by the Inspiration Center, by the BDF camp. Again, that water used to run off in Kruman Lagoon and Gungulung. That block, there are massive development going on in this area who block this area, and so the water has no way to run. So that water stays on the road and deteriorate the road, make it miserable for drivers, pedestrians who want to use that road. This is almost $1 million. Almost $1 million, because, you know, the streets, they are secondary streets. They are, you know, and when that water came and the drains, and I must say again, many people ask why some of the areas that is black, why the water? It is a part of people either building, so they put material in the drain, dumping garbage in front of their yard, cleaning it, you know. And all of this is a blockage. The council tried its best. The Trunks Council have been out there opening up these waterway, right? And so we find that many of the floods, the water couldn't get off because of those problems we have with the citizens. No? The concrete street that we have, right? Many of those streets have suffered under the floods again, right? Because they were not properly built. And so the council find itself now trying to find a way how we are going to, you know, repair these streets. Cost a lot of money.
And given the economic situation that we're in now, where are you guys going to possibly find that money?
Well, I have spoken to the mayor, and I am saying that the best... We now have a PUP central government. First, we had a government that was not assistance in any way, right? And so we must find time now to sit with Honorable Julius Despot and his technical people and find a way out. We would definitely need the help of the central government. Right? I mean, they say, you know, taxes are not performing the way, if you listen to the mayor's recent speech, businesses is down, taxes is not coming in, right? And so we don't have that type of money. So we will definitely have to sit down with the minister's spot and see how best we can work together and sort out some of these problems.
And after the floods, there remain the potholes. It's a pressing infrastructural matter, and one that, as you heard, the city council can't afford to fix. Now, all the citizenry of the old capital can hope is that a blue council appealing to a blue central government will make all the difference in facilitating of getting things done. Cherise Halso, 7 News.
Avon also told us that last week's flooding in the city exposed what he says is, quote, the complete failure of the flood mitigation project, a loan that was supposed to facilitate drainage out of Belama and into the sea and in the Hallover Creek. We'll take a break now. When we come back, we'll change gears a little and show you how LPG or butane reaches from the depot into your home. And Compaw Williams loses one in court to Corporal Eldon Narzu. Don't go away.
Belize,
Benny's Deal Alert season is here, and we have some great deals for you.
Deals, deals, and more deals. From now up until December 31st, enjoy Deal Alert discounts on our line of paints, such as BH paints, Texture Light paints, and Tropical Colors paints. Deal Alert markdowns will also be applied on a wide selection of tiles, lights and fans, tools, appliances, and much more.
And remember, whenever you make a purchase, you get double tickets to enter our cash giveaway draw on December 19th to win $10,000.
That's right. It's a Deal Alert. It's a Bennett's Deal Alert. So shop now, get great deals and your tickets for the chance to win the $10,000 grand prize only at Benny's.
Benny's in 60 seconds.
The brain. It's just not working very well. Find out.
Last week, Friday, we gave you a preview of our tour of the National Gas Company's brand new Stan Creek LPG facility. That's where the public-private company has established Belize's first marine terminal to receive cooking gas, which Belizeans know better as butane. National Gas has replaced the big Central American company's Southern Choice Butane, formerly known as Zeta Gas, Gas Tumza, and Belize Western Energy Limited, as Belize's only importer of LPG. As viewers will remember, the former importers have been on a campaign to discredit National Gas even before they officially introduced themselves to the general public. On Friday, after months of finalizing their operations, the National Gas Company invited 7 News in to see how they do business as a $60 million investment. Our news team took a tour of their Independence Village facility, and Daniel Ortiz has that story.
This unassuming building is the office of the National Gas Company's Operations Center and Oversight Facility in Independence Village, Stan Creek District. This entire compound is situated basically right next door to the port of Big Creek, and it was strategically placed there. This location allows for Belize to have its first marine LPG terminal. The country's international LPG suppliers can ship monthly quantities of the cooking gas to provide stable and uninterrupted access for consumers.
It all really starts by the dockside in the port of Big Creek. There, a ship comes every 4 weeks, 4 to 5 weeks, depending on the consumption for that month, and it brings about 1.2 million gallons of LPG. And when I say LPG, I mean it brings two separate products. It brings butane and it brings propane. It docks there. We will then connect to that ship with our hoses.
The terminal is directly connected to the facility's 19 megatanks through a series of underground pipes that were constructed with safety and durability in mind. This facility has to be insulated as best as possible from the risk of an industrial fire, since over 1 million gallons of highly flammable fuel are stored here.
From there to our main facility where our tanks are is about 1,500 feet of pipeline. We have 8-inch line, 6-inch line. They go underground and then they come to our facility. Belize doesn't necessarily have building codes for an LPG facility. We had to look to the US codes. There's one in particular called the NFPA 58, National Fire Protection Association. Code 58 is specific for LPG. At our facility, the propane goes into its own batch of tanks and the butane goes into its own batch of tanks. We have 6 tanks dedicated for butane and we have 12 tanks dedicated for propane. So after that, those products are blended and they're put into what we call the blend tank.
The blend that the operations manager is referring to is the legally regulated mix of 70% propane and 30% butane that you should be getting. If a company is pumping a higher percentage of propane into your tank, you aren't getting fair value. If your mix doesn't have 30% butane, your gas will run out faster. Another important detail is that the National Gas Company doesn't sell directly to you, the consumer. As the importer, they sell to the butane companies, which retails to you whenever you call one of them to refill your tank.
We have a specific system that's for blending, and that does it according to what the Belize Bureau of Standards dictates. In our case, we're allowed to blend 70-30, or 70% propane and 30% butane. Now, if a customer requires a different blend, they'd have to go through the Belize Bureau of Standards to get that. When a customer makes an order, then we'll know how much product to blend. Blending starts at the blend skid, which is on our left over there. And the device basically has some of the most accurate meters that are available. They're called micromotion Coriolis meters. And those detect the exact amount of product and also compensates for temperature and pressure. Those meters are there to make sure that we get the right accuracy rather than some false figure that might be misleading.
Those micromotion Coriolis meters are the most expensive pieces of equipment on this compound. But National Gas invested heavily in them as a key oversight and consumer protection feature.
They do real-time calculation on the exact amount of liquid that's passing through there, if it's liquid or if it's in a gas phase. And then it also looks at the temperature and pressure and says, this is exactly what went into the customer's truck. Not less, not more, it's a fair amount. And that's standard to 60 degrees Fahrenheit. There is not one other device that's more expensive than that on the compound.
NGC also has a delivery service that is used for customers who meet a certain threshold.
Larger customers who order 10,000 gallons or more, it's our trucks who actually go and do that delivery. Smaller trucks that are about 2,200 gallons and up are the ones that actually come to our facilities to do purchasing.
All of the company's main functions and features, including its real-time vehicle fleet tracking system, is done from its control room.
The control room is our main hub of information. Basically, all activities are approved through here. Some of our main functions here, apart from making sure we keep things safe, is also to keep things on track, on schedule. A big part of our relationship is not only receiving product, but it's getting it to our customers. We have a schedule that people are expecting product to be on a specific day at a specific time. So our control room operator here basically monitors our trucks. We have our fleet tracking system, which is this screen over here. And on that screen, you'll be able to see that it tells you the location of your trucks. It tells you what time was the last time that they passed a specific point, if they stopped, how long did they stop. And then it allows for the control room operator to be able to call that person up and say, hey, what's up? What's going on? I noticed you stopped for more than 5 minutes. Is everything okay?
We know exactly where the truckers will start. We go based by the schedule. Along with that basically schedule of what where exactly we're going to send product. If there's any changes, they would notify me based on an email, and from there I would update the schedule, call the drivers.
All three facilities, before a truck could even receive product, the control room has to be the one to actually press that final button. The operators will call and say, hey, we're ready to load. He'll be able to see here if the truck is connected. He'll verify verbally with the guys over the radio or over the phone. And then he'll give that final press of a button. From here, he's able to see the amount of product that is in each tank in each facility. So we'll, you know, if they're consuming product, even before they call and say they need more product, he'll be able to send a truck to a facility because they need it. He can see that they need it.
Reporting for 7 News, Daniel Ortiz.
The National Gas Company has two other branch facilities as part of its supply chain for the retail companies, one in Orange Walk and the other in Belmopan, where the company's corporate headquarters are located. Police Corporal Eldon Arzu, the former chairman of the Police Association, has been in court with Police Commissioner Chester Williams for months now. Arzu is complaining that the commissioner displayed bias against him. He asserts to the court that before the June 2020 elections for the Police Association executives, the commissioner arbitrarily extended the nomination process, which allowed for Sergeant Jane Usher and her team to enter elections long after the deadlines set by the Police Association's election rules. Usher's slate won those elections and she was selected as the 2020 chairman. But it turns out that Corporal Arzu has a separate lawsuit against the commissioner, and it focuses on a dispute over the leadership of the association from 2019. We are told that in January 2019 elections, Corporal Arzu Slate won 4 seats on the Police Association's central board, and Inspector Usher Slate won 3. The 7-member board agreed that Usher should continue leading the association as chairman. We understand that on the day of the 2019 Police Association elections, the Police Association's constitution was amended with a statutory instrument which disqualified any chairman from serving more than 2 terms. The commissioner's amendment was supposed to be retroactive to 2013 when Arzu first became the association's chairman. He then refused to recognize Arzu's presidency after the 2019 election and reassigned Arzu to a different police unit away from the Police Association. This retroactivity issue was heard before Justice Westman James, who ruled today that the SI, which was used to stop Arzu from retaining the chairmanship, was not retroactive. The outstanding issues of the commissioner's decision to transfer Arzu out of the Police Association to another unit and other issues are still before Justice James. We understand that judge has indicated to the litigants to discuss these issues to see if an out-of-court resolution can be arrived at since the retroactivity dispute has been resolved. And while this outcome was described to us by the Arzu camp as an important win, the other side is disagreeing that it's anything significant. One government attorney tells us, quote, he, the compul, didn't lose. It was a preliminary point of law which did not dispose of the issue before the court, end quote. That attorney tells us that this first lawsuit will still proceed to trial. At the top of the news, we told you about COVID's increasingly large footprint in Belize that has extended to many in the senior ranks of the PUP. Well, the latest figures show that on Friday, there were 164 deaths recorded. Tonight, 72 hours later, there are 176 deaths. Out of 421 tests, there are 184 new cases reported today, a positivity rate of 30.4%. As this number show, Belize is struggling with the COVID-19 pandemic, but the government of Taiwan continues to make generous donations to the Belize government in an effort to better equip the frontline medical personnel to manage this public health crisis. Today, the Taiwanese embassy officially handed over a grant of 1.1 million Belize dollars as part of the project for strengthening medical imaging systems in Belize. According to the government, the grant will be used to assist in the improvement of medical imaging services and to procure digital imaging equipment referred to as computed radiography and a picture archiving and communication system for three major public hospitals in the country. The donation also included an emergency medical material kit, which included medicines and other portable equipment to aid the victims of the recent floods. The embassy also handed over 5,000 isolation gowns and 30,000 surgical masks for Belize's medical service providers and frontline personnel fighting the pandemic. Here's what the Taiwanese ambassador and the health minister had to say at the official handing over ceremony.
I'm also extremely honored to hand over the first tranche of the Project for Strengthening Medical Imaging Systems to the government of Belize. The grant will be used for the improvement of medical imaging services in public hospitals such as KHMH, Western, and Northern hospitals, especially for procuring computed radiography or the CR equipment and picture archiving and communication system, abbreviated as PACS or PACS. Based upon this project, two Belizean doctors are currently receiving a three-year-long radiologist residency training courses in Taiwan, Dr. Smith and Dr. Rivera. Besides these two doctors, IT technicians and radiographers will also visit Taiwan for training in the near future. I believe those doctors specializing in radiology, radiographers, and IT technicians will come back to Belize as seed instructors incubating more professionals in this key area for Belize.
I extend our greatest appreciation for the support we have received over the years from the Republic of China, Taiwan, especially on the project agreement, Project for Strengthening Medical Imaging Systems, between the Ministry of Health and Wellness and the Embassy of Republic of China, Taiwan. The Ministry hereby acknowledges the donation made possible through the project agreement, where the first of two disbursements, a total of Belize 1,100,000, has been received. I thank the Republic of Taiwan and the Ambassador for his contribution to the Ministry of Health and Wellness, especially for the collaboration in these times of COVID-19 pandemic. The Ministry also recognizes three additional donations, including an emergency medical kit, medicine, and portable equipment for those suffered from the flooding, as well as 5,000 isolation gowns and 30,000 surgical masks for the medical service providers and first responders combating COVID-19 in Belize.
Gun violence continued in the city today as a student was shot just after midday. 19-year-old Mikhail Novella was driving a Honda CR-V at the corner of Frederick and Pickstock Streets with his brother in the passenger seat when they heard shots being fired. Novello crashed into a parked Jeep and sustained a shot to his upper back. He was rushed to the KHMH where he was admitted in a stable condition. The Caribbean Women in Leadership Network has established a new Belizean chapter. The membership organization is a non-political, multi-partisan group and represents women from all spheres of life with the common objective of enabling and empowering women to participate equally in leadership and decision-making. Its Belizean chapter, which is the sixth in the Caribbean, was established on November 27, 2020, starts out with an initial group of 75 women as members from across Belize and the diaspora. And this brand new network chapter has a brand new chairperson. She's a former senator and former FCD board member, Valerie Woods. Woods will head an executive committee elected to serve a two-year inaugural term. CWIL has active national chapters in Antigua and Barbuda, the Bahamas, St. Kitts and Nevis, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, and Trinidad and Tobago. Pharoah King, he's the LA-based Belizean-born Brockdung artist, but he's also a storyteller. That's what he's doing with his new 10-song album, Dugunani, a celebratory 10-song album that he says will have you dancing, singing, and laughing from the stories revealed in each song. And this afternoon, via Zoom, he spoke to Cherise Halsall about the album's first single, Shall I Baby, and the music video that sees him brought to heel by his own granny on the Maury Povich Show.
She can tell me granny that me that she baby daddy. Who me?
As a musician, I'm more of a storyteller. And so my songs are all like stories and it's comedy and, you know, but what I wanted my beat to represent is another thing that I love and that I'm known for in Belize, and that's my dancing. Instead of actually get up and dance and, you know, show them all the new, instead of actually get up and dance and show them this old boy the move, I rather to like, you know, my music is gonna be the thing that make them dance. So my beats are like fire. They could, you know, once you hear it, you're gonna start moving. And then when you start hearing the lyrics, you're gonna start laughing.
Granny tell everybody she's a raspy thing. 60 years later, I deny shall I be a bee. Oh my sweet granny, why can't you see? That baby that might be picking, the baby dance just like it. Can't believe it.
That's the only question I had. It was you talk about storytelling and it seems that the story here is very Jerry Springer-esque. So let's hear about that.
Yeah, well, basically, Shall I Baby, the song itself, you know, I got inspiration from a song from Donkey Man. One time, Donkey Man, he was recording this song, and I was there in the studio with him. And then years later, Donkey Man never released the song. And I got a rhythm, and I was like, you know what? To listen, and I just started to like, you know, lyrics just started to come, and I was like, you know what, I'm gonna run with this. And so I come up with Shall I Baby, and you know, I call this song my version of Billie Jean, because you know, I'm a huge Michael Jackson fan. So Shall I Baby is my version of Billie Jean, you know, basically Billie Jean. I like, Billie Jean is not my lover, so basically now Sheila, she is not my lover. And she just to give me a Shall I Baby out here, you know, so.
She not tell me granny me that she baby daddy. Who, me?
Yes, you.
She not tell me granny that me that she baby daddy.
I said Brockdung, it's the one genre of music that many people consider uniquely Belizean. Is that something that you could agree with, and if so, why? And why is Brockdung so important to you as an artist?
Brockdung, I love Brockdung because it's I love the stories. I love the stories, so that's why I love Brockdung. But I think that, you know, Brockdung isn't the only music that we could consider Belizean completely. I also think that Punta Rock was created in Belize, and so I think Punta Rock could be considered completely Belizean also, you know what I mean? And even though, you know, people choose to say, oh, it's Garifuna music, really Punta is Garifuna music. Punta Rock is Belizean music. It was created in Belize, and a lot of Belizeans, Garifuna Creole, East Indian Mestizo, every type of ethnicity that we have in Belize have contributed to Punta Rock music in some way or the other since the start.
And Pharoah King says that all his music is available for free on YouTube. But if you'd like to support him and the Brockdung genre, his songs are also streaming on every major platform. And that's all we have for you for tonight. Thanks for watching. With your news, I'm Indira Craig. Remember that you can see a streaming video of this newscast at 7newsbelize.com. Brought to you by Digi for the best postpaid plans in the country. Remember now to wash your hands, to wear a mask at all times in public, and to keep your social distance. Join me back here tomorrow at 6, and until then, have a great night. Nobody.